I'm Kelsey Moser, and you're watching Thorin's YouTube channel, where no sandbagging goes unscrutinized.
In case you're unaware, I have a clips channel where you'll see smaller, bite-sized, single topics, juicy aspects, funny banter from my shores, including Summoning Insight, some of my other shit, and from my long videos, my interviews, etc. Now, Worlds is the most important tournament in League of Legends, thus, it is logically the most impactful on the careers of players. Thus, it is the most memorable to fans. And quite frankly, it's the easiest for fans to understand, theoretically. As you'll see in this video, maybe it's a little bit trickier than they realize. The issue is, though, because it's the World Championship and the way the structure of the circuit goes in League of Legends, it only happens once a year. And that's why, for example, I've often tried to argue that people should treat MSI as like 75 to 80% of a Worlds, because it still has elite squads, it means a lot to win it still, you get a second crack at it, so if you like RNG, you don't win at Worlds, you can still prove you're extremely good at a different point in the year. Now listen, yes, as a result of it not having as many great teams overall, to make a final means less, to make a semi-final means less than Worlds potentially, because Worlds has many Korean teams, many Chinese teams. It's very, very difficult to win in that regard. Now, the upside to all these aspects of Worlds is the excitement that is generated, how much results get burned into people's memories, just seared into their imaginations. Yeah, that's one of the things that people love about Worlds, right? The downside, though, is the dark or the shadow side of exactly what I just said, which is fans overreacting to results, making an entire guy's career get retconned by that, negatively or positively, cherry-picking results, taking one result and saying, wow, this result in the semis, look at that, he was amazing. That's it. What about the rest of the group? Oh, never mind that. And or looking at one result in the group, ah, this guy lost in group stage, and all because of this one best of one of this team, must be absolute shit. You said he was one of the best Korean players. Ridiculous stuff. The narrative of the player's entire career can be warped completely out of shape, like some funhouse fucking mirror, just by a single best of one result at times, or the implications or the impact of that best of one result. So let's start with the idea of people just overreacting to the results. So first of all, the obvious one is that if you don't qualify for a Worlds that year, or ever, you must just be shit and you can't possibly be the best player. Now, that's already fallacious logic when you apply it to LCS and to LEC, etc. But for LPL and LCK, China and Korea, it's especially absurd. Because in the past, for example, when China and Korea only had the three seeds each, the fourth best Chinese team or the fourth best Korean team could potentially have won Worlds and potentially was better than the best team from LCS, LMS, LEC. Like, if I go back to season 3, right, based on the way the rankings worked, KT Bullets weren't a top 3 team. They obviously were. They were actually the second best team, arguably, in the world. Now, if they'd have gone to Worlds, depending on how the bracket goes, they might have won Worlds. KT Arrows, the one that had won the summer, but failed in the regional. If they go to season 4 Worlds, I mean, again, they'd probably have to get some weird scenario happening in the bracket, but they're a team that could potentially have won Worlds or being a top team or second place or a third place team. But again, they're now forgotten except for that one. Everyone says, yes, it was a fluke. It was, but that's part of the problem is they don't understand that. You don't know what they might have done at Worlds in that scenario. Now, what part of this issue of the overreacting is then you go to people at Worlds. So, okay, if you underperform at Worlds, it's punished, it's criticized. Yeah, that's justifiable, that's what should happen. But it's punished way too hard, it goes completely out of whack. The classic example is Nami was apparently a fraud who was never that good because in season 4 at Worlds, he was just kind of meh, he was just all right. But coming into that tournament, people saying he's the best ADC in the world. Do you know why? Because if you go and watch his body of work in the LPL for the last 2 years, he was the best ADC in the world. And there's also even the story where he apparently like was quite ill during Worlds, so what, is that implausible to imagine that that might have affected the way he played? I mean, if people don't know, at Season 4 Worlds, when he was entering that tournament, he had an insane domestic record. He'd won 3 LPL titles back to back to back, and he'd been in all 4 LPL finals. By the way, you might think, yeah, but he was in the best team in Season 4. First of all, because he made it the best team, he was the best player. And in Season 3, he wasn't in the best team. Meanwhile, at that point in time, Uzi, who at the end of Season 4 Worlds had been in 2 Worlds finals, and everyone was hailing him, maybe he's the best ADC already. Is he better than Wei Zhao? He's definitely better than Nami. Well, you know what people ignored? Uzi had never even played in an LPL final. 0 LPL titles. Domestically, Nami was the better player, especially when he's called Devil. I think a classic example who's been haunted by this has got to be Deft. Now, I agree. I think he's a chalker. I think he's got some of the problems that Peyton Manning had in his career, for example. And as a result, I think it's justifiable that you might want to deny him GOAT status. But the idea he's not even allowed to be in the conversation. Like, for my money, the three most obvious people who get, the four most obvious people who have to be in the GOAT conversation, it's fake, it goes without saying. It's not Uzi next, by the way. Then it's rookie. Then it's Uzi and then death. Those are the four that clearly get in there. The others are all debatable and they're more fringe cases. One day I'll do some content on it. I'll even say this. It's funny, people used to rag on rookie until he won LPL and until he went to Worlds again, that like they acted like he was farming LCS. Like if you said somebody is the best top lane now, people would go, yeah, we just reckon LCS, isn't he? They acted like that's what rookie was doing for all those years where he was hard carrying IG in the LPL. Like if he was really that good, he'd play in LCK or something like that. Mate, LPL was better than LCK in terms of like level of competition. His team just had a load of fucking flaws until he got the shy, basically. How about overperformance? My God, this is the one that probably tilts me the most. Overperformance is then rewarded to such an insane degree as to make the rest of people's careers almost worthless. Like, every Fnatic fan in Season 9, Season 10 had their times when they banged on Bwipo. But fucking hell, he was so overrated coming into Season 9, it was mental. Like, because when he was a rookie and he was at Worlds, and he was dominating, and then he shot on Licorice, who looked good, and he was a rookie at Worlds, and he was beating all these Asian players. And you know what we all ignored? He had the beginner's luck aspect. He had a beginner's mind. He didn't know he could fail in that sense. He even sort of made himself at that high, sort of like he had to overcome what the regression to the mean was. The meta also hit him completely in the face. And even at the tournament where he was in his god mode, peak mode, best form ever, everything going perfectly, the shy still went, I told you once, I told you twice, go to fucking bed. It was just done. He was just over. That was his best ever tournament, boys. He is a really good player. I still think, actually, when all's said and done, he'll be remembered as one of the great EU top laners. But the point is, look at how you overreacted for one tournament. One tournament. Oh, I'd say half a year then. So we'll say like MSI. We'll say playoff spring, MSI. Summer sort of, you sometimes play in bot lane, and then Worlds particularly. So, all right, let's say most of the year then. Well, I was a year's over, but the Season 8 Worlds is obviously what capped it for that one. I think Season 8 IG, the one that won in general, man, were they overrated. They were only the best at that one tournament, guys. Yes, they were stomping in the spring, in the fucking regular season. No one gives a fuck about regular season when you're in LPL. Like, loads of teams come in like third or fourth in the rankings and then win the fucking league. Look how many times the team that's number one in the standings at the end of the split wins the actual LPL at the end. That's a league that's exactly about core stage, getting your playoff spot, decent seed, and then you bang them in the playoffs. Top esports basically just entered a bunch of the last games of the split just to not give away any fucking information when they're waiting in that semi for Sunny. For Sunning, not at Worlds, idiot. I'm talking about the LPL. Get your fucking head in shape. That tournament and that year, before the first match was played, the best team in the world was from China. It was RNG. They were clearly the best team. It wasn't fucking IG. Season 9, the champions FPX, they weren't the best team in the world by any stretch of the imagination until they beat G2. Straight up. They almost lost to IG without a fucking, almost essentially playing without a jungler. And having Baolan just be god tier at being a fucking Inter. I mean, man alive. I mean, the Shy didn't help himself in that series, did he? So the overreactions, it's nuts. In my opinion, here's a good one for you. Maybe I'll do a video on this one time. The only real best team of the year that actually won Worlds, I think it only happened three times ever. I think it happened in Season 3 with SKT. I think it happened in Season 5 with SKT. I think it happened in Season 10 with Damwon Gaming. I think they're the only ones that when you look back on the year, on average, including the Worlds win, they were the best team of the year. Every other season, it's debatable. Oh, there was another team that was better, but then the other one won the Worlds, like IG and RNG. Like, there's a whole set of angles. In terms of players, it doesn't have to just be teams here. I'll tell you another classic one. How about Season 7 Ignar? If you go back, first of all, talk to real experts about the game. And if you go back and even watch that Misfits SKT series, because he only got his advantages off his strengths and his weaknesses held him back. Even in that series, he has issues and isn't a total god. People overrated him from that. The one that I'd bring up very briefly, just to trigger y'all, without fucking going into a massive thing, because one day I'll do a massive piece of content on this and just expose how absolute nonsense the narrative is. It's got to be Season 6 Bengi, a guy who was fully benched, was never going to be a starter. The only reason he got in that Rock series is because, yes, Blank used to fall apart sometimes in the big games. And even that Nidalee pick, y'all act like he ultra-carried the game and was sick on Nidalee. I'd just say, go get the best Nidalee players in the world. Show them that game and ask, what the fuck is Peanut doing? What is he doing with this logic? How is he playing against this? And is Bengi really smurfing there? Is he doing super sick shit? It's one game. From one game, you're going to make this guy a god. I thought it was an amazing game. Here's the thing with Bengi, right? This is not going to be a great analogy because you can never get a perfect fit. But my analogy would be this. Do you know who Julian Edelman is in the NFL? He's won a bunch of Super Bowls with Tom Brady, right? He's a wide receiver and he tends to play like the sort of slot receiver. He's basically taken over fucking Wes Welker's job, hasn't he? And then with Brady, can't see, I mean, he barely looks for it anymore. He would just always throw it to fucking Edelman and Gronk, right? Because they would just go like under the coverage and he would throw it to him and they get like a good 10, 15 yards. Now, the thing with Edelman is, if you just go off regular season and who he is as a player with the eye test, he would never get in the Hall of Fame. Not a regular season Hall of Famer. But I tell you what, I predict he will be a Hall of Famer at the end of his career. Because in playoffs, he's had some massive clutch performances, some moments where he just did shit that's way better than someone on his level should be doing. It's not a perfect analogy, but that is Bengi. You can't take only the high moments and go, that's who he was. It's like, no, those are the high moments. What are the low moments? What was the curve between? Let's look at the delta. I don't have to explain how to think, surely, for fuck's sake. So just don't even go there on Bengi in season six, boys. He was a trash can, but then somehow he pulled it out with a miracle. He did a Robert Horry. So fair play to him. I respect his performance in that game to some degree. Definitely not making him a god. Now, if you think overreactions are bad, the cherry picking, which kind of ties into the Bengi one, that makes it even worse. First of all, people focus only on Worlds and retcon your whole team's success before that. Or to go even further, they'll just pick a result they like, nearly always the last one, because Western people are really trapped in the concept of linear thinking. It's funny, they think that's called cause and effect. Well, this happened and then this happened. No, they don't understand cause and effect is like this happened and it made all these things happen and then they made all those things happen and it fractal effect out across the universe. It's the butterfly effect. That's what cause and effect is. That's what the alchemical principle of cause and effect is. People don't get it though. So basically, let's do some of these. I'll start where we're on relevant that you're going to know so we can have some fun with this. And by the way, yeah, that's right. I'm just pulling all these fucking streams in here and connecting them and doing all this. You can't do this, boy. Your favorite content creator can't do this. Sit the fuck down, get a cup of cocoa, stop crying and enjoy the video. Season 10, Fnatic. Remember that? They came to Worlds. What did they do? Quarterfinals. What a strong performance to end the year. iTest played like fucking legends, heroes. The way they played brought pride to the European region and the history of League of Legends we have here. And how's it going to be remembered? They almost beat TES. Yeah, they did. But let's be fair, let's add in that context now though. The same TES who at that tournament were roundly and justifiably criticised for underperforming and not being close to the best team in the tournament by the end of the tournament. So as a result, now that we know all that and that we're going to criticise, including Fnatic fans, that TES team, now let's put it in the context that Fnatic didn't beat them, but almost did. How impressive is not beating that team? Yeah, it's taken a little bit of the shine out of it, right? Not on the Fnatic side of the equation. iTest looked awesome. But in terms of the context of what it meant to win that one, right? If you're an EU fan, you always bag on C9 because you're like, well, who cares if you beat a freak of freaks? Like, look how they played at Worlds. It's like, okay, let's do that to your team then. Let's be fair. What's good for the goose is good for the gander, right? If you don't know what that means, look it up. Or fuck off and watch geese. Well, probably not going to get that much from observing geese. Then again, you can't even have the eyes to watch fucking League of Legends. So that result, here's my problem. That result gets more praise than when Team Liquid at Season 9 MSI didn't just beat, they didn't almost beat, and oh, we lost so close. They straight up beat in a best of 5, 3-1, not even 3-2. They 3-1'd the reigning world champions, Invictus Gaming, who were not only the reigning world champions and the LPL champions, but the team that after the group stage, after blitzing everyone, were the most favoured to win MSI. And people act like that doesn't even mean anything. It's not a big deal. People act like my boy K is like, oh, what did he do? Just help Fnatic get the Season 8 finals and them get to an MSI final with Team Liquid, beat the best team in the world. Fuck. What did he do? Just a stupid guy with tweets. You're the stupid guy with tweets. You're the one who's done nothing. Stop projecting, motherfucker. Sit down, classes in session. Listen. So let's talk about that. The same Fnatic that did that result of almost beating TES. True. Same Fnatic finished second in their group. Well, that's weird, isn't it? Because their group didn't have a single tournament favourite in it. It's weird if they were a team that's super duper mega. Why didn't they just win their group, right? Well, I'll tell you why they didn't. Because they lost to Gen G, right? You remember that? same Gen G that we're now told, because they lost to G2, is overrated and not that good, and everyone should shut the fuck up about BDD. Listen, I agree they're overrated. I agree people should chill on the BDD thing, but they were still a good team. Like, that was still a team that, if they'd have beaten G2, might have been at least fun to watch them play against Dam 1. They were one of the few teams that had a chance to potentially beat Dam 1. I don't think they would have, but they were potentially like the fifth best team at Worlds. They beat Fnatic. Same Fnatic, you're not going to like this one, lost to LGD, who people still say sucks because of overreacting to the planes and then saying, well, TSM sucked anyway, and then just ignoring that, well, they beat Fnatic in a game. What, are they? Do their games not count when they win? How does this fucking work, boys? Now let's go back to the LEC. So the same Fnatic, coming into the last week of LEC summer, had a losing record. They were like 7-9 or some shit. They were in a really precarious position where they wouldn't have made playoffs if, I think, XL had beaten them and then Schalke didn't beat Mad Lions, who in theory had been one of the best teams in the split. So this, the Schalke miracle run basically helped them, and then they had that meaningless game against SK, who were both in the playoffs. Like, they ended up finishing with a 50% record, for fuck's sake, a 9-9. And they had no excuses, like G2 did with some of the extenuating circumstances. Now, in the playoffs, I'm not cherry-picking. I'm taking it all into context here. Again, class in session. Take notes. Then they went into the playoffs, beat Rogue handily, beat G2 in a best of five. That's legit. Made the final. Yeah, they then got beaten, you know, convincingly in the final. That's legit. But the point is, all of that counts. Not equally, but all of it has to be put into its place and connected and contextually explained. You can't just ignore the rest of the split. You can't just ignore this. In the same way as I wouldn't just say, ignore that they beat G2 and had any results in the playoffs because they got 3-0'd in the final, so obviously they're just trash. Like, no, it doesn't work that way. But because of that TES result, the top esports result, it will now just be remembered that they were monsters. That this year was a great year for them. Don't overrate it. Let's do some more. How about Season 8 Cloud9? I referenced them before. They were all over the place, guys. Like, for the year, even before that Worlds result, they were the second best team of the year. But think about this. No one would have said that after spring, but they had this weird tie in the regular part of spring where after, like, they lost the tiebreaker, somehow they then ended up meeting Team Liquid in the first round of the playoffs because Team Liquid had their own issues. Team Liquid were the eventual champs, and so they lost in a close series, right? At the end of the tournament, they arguably played the best series against Team Liquid. They looked like they were the second best team overall anyway. Then in summer, they were in last place at one point in time, did that sick, 7-8 game winning streak to get to the playoffs, lost to Team Liquid in the final because they were the best. But then, who were the other teams competing with them for second best title in NA, right? 100 Thieves dropped off big time. TSM were in position, right? But TSM lost them in the semis, and then they actually swept TSM in the regional. So they were clearly the second best team of the year, pre-Worlds anyway. But if you didn't want to be a hater, you could have said, who cares, you're round of six, last play. You could have done that, right? So then we go to Worlds, though. This is how they get overrated. So it starts out with the match everyone likes to forget, because you all just cherry pick, which is that they were in the planes and in the qualifier, best of five, against Gambit from CIS, from LCL or whatever, who have old-ass players like Diamond Prox and fucking Edward. The players, you're like, stop overrating Gambit Game like and Moscow 5. I'm overrating the one in your mind from Season 2 and Season 3. These motherfuckers were still playing in Season 8 all those years later, and the series was 3-2 with those old-ass Gambit players. Then they get in the group stage and they have a fucking war. After the first week, they win one game against Vitality and they lose against RNG, who, remember, don't win Worlds, and they lose against Gen G, the one that everyone remembers laughing at, the reigning world champions that shit the bed in that group stage. You know why? Because in the second round robin, which was done in one day, they 3-0'd the group. They beat all of them. And then I think they lost like a fucking tiebreaker to RNG or whatever. So then they go into the, by the way, who doesn't make top four this Worlds? So then they go into the, and by the way, they got, like I said, they got busted up by Gen G. Then they go into the round of eight and they play a Freak of Freaks. Arguably the easiest opposition of the ones in the round of eight, but still a strong team. Yes, they swept them. Sick accomplishment in the context of NA, one of the most impressive ever, arguably ever at that point in time. Semis, they got smashed by Fnatic and it was embarrassing. They weren't even that good in it. They weren't even close to making that a series. So which is it, right? Were they sick because of the top four, beating Koreans and RNG and Gen G in the group, in some sense? Were they overrated because they were 10th in summer at one point in time, almost lost to Gambit in the qualifier, were in a bad spot going into week two of Worlds, and then got bodied by Fnatic? In some sense, Let's keep going. You're going to like this. Season 10 TSM, you just saw them play, right? They won LCS Summer. But even in winning, they were shit right into like halfway into the playoffs. And then they turned it around. And how did they turn it around? No dominant wins. Aside from the C9 series, they were getting super close wins. But fans treated it like they were convincing wins. And as a result, expectations went unreasonable. They got a Worlds, best possible group you could hope for. They were ultra bad, only in a hyperbolic sense. But they got a very good one. Ultra bad at Worlds. Zero excuses. Here's a great paraphrase for you. TSM excuses are like arseholes. They all have them and they all stink. Now, the reason why I hate this topic is because Season 10 is going to ruin things. Because Suning, with their amazing underdog run, have basically ruined all the Chinese narratives and just made them ruin. So I'm just going to say this right now. For historical purposes, any LPL expert listening to me right now, it is our duty, if we care about the history of the game, I want to safeguard it for future generations, that we don't let the current generation ruin it with lies and bullshit narratives and carry them forwards. We must protect those narratives and we must carry them so that the future generations hear them from us and we counteract this bullshit. You have to go against the grain of public opinion on this one. Suning came into Worlds as the third best Chinese team, but clearly the third best Chinese team. Although there was the debate, what if Shy hadn't been a shithead in the fucking regional playoffs and actually IG had made it. But ignore that for a second. They were better than LGD. JDG, though, had the players to win Worlds in pretty solid form before the groups. Top Esports had the strengths to just straight up win Worlds. They even had probably one of the only setups that could potentially have beaten Damwon on Gaming. But the narrative will be Suning was the best. The others were all overrated. But somehow, them beating the teams that are all overrated then makes them... who the fuck knows how the mental gymnastics work? I even see this affecting my colleagues, kind of like I alluded to with the LPL thing there. So I just want to say this right now. And if you're one of the people watching, there's only a handful of you, but you're going to know who you are when I say this. Think this through, because it's driven you guys mad. The LPL experts in particular, for past seasons, have been plagued by this need to take the final result of Worlds and have it make sense. And when I say make sense, think that they know, like the world is predetermined, exactly how it all had to work, but after the fact doing that. Some of my favourite writers in esports are doing this, even though that's the one part I don't like about their work. So they construct these anime plot lines about how the team evolved or how they didn't learn from something, as if it always had to go this way, and as if they'd done X, they definitely would have gotten Y. But instead they did Z and they got A. It's not as simple as that. If a 1 out of 10 chance happens, do you go, well, it was always going to happen and here's why? No, you go, it's a 1 out of 10 chance. 9 out of 10 times, that doesn't happen. It's still very unlikely. I can do that. You guys have got to get to this place. Study Buddhism. Study concepts like real skepticism. Not just listening to what someone else says who you think is more informed. Being skeptical of all of it. Asking the right questions. Poking holes in your own theory. Steel man your opponent's arguments. Do all these things and this will bring you to not only an intellectual freedom, but an intellectual paradise. We can have a fucking utopia when we discuss this on these shows. One of the reasons me and Dom have very interesting discussions when we go back and forth on the crackdown is we have the intellectual respect to let the other person have their points and to concede when they make a good one or to consider it properly or to ask, well, are you making the argument this in this case? And steel man their argument for them. Don't try to only poke holes in it in that sense. I just want to say this one last thing. And it's something that if you think about, you'll get a real sense of what this video was about. And you might be able to, I won't say I find the answer, but get towards some more interesting ones. It goes like this, from one of my favorite philosophers, thinkers, authors, Robert Anton Wilson. And he was quoting a guy who I'm assuming is like an Indian guru or something, a guy called Sri Siadsti. And he said, all affirmations are true in some sense, false in some sense, meaningless in some sense, true and false in some sense, true and meaningless in some sense, false and meaningless in some sense, and true and false and meaningless in some sense. And if you repeat this 523 times, you will achieve supreme enlightenment in some sense. Context. This video was kindly supported by Pronogo, Mohammed Al Abdul Razak, Dean Tanglis, James Peterson, Vatrisam, Eric Hillestad, Andreas Crocknies, Hades, Zumba Gaming, J Dubs, Tobias Bernasconi, and Alexander Rao. Special thanks, as always, goes out to Jerky's Minion. Would you like to suggest a topic or a guest for one of my upcoming episodes? Maybe you want to ask more of those questions in that video AMA I do each month. Do you want teasers? Find out who the next guests are for my shows. Well, maybe you even want to take part in one of those crazy donated discussions where we go all over the place. If any of these perks appeal to you, or you want to support the channel, put your money where your mouth is and join the Scrolluminati today at the Patreon link in the description box below.